So, hello everybody, I'm Alejandro Piñeiro. I'm going to give a presentation about GSPCB, about the work in progress bringing this extension to Mesa. But first, so I would like to make some announcements. The first one is that the XDC is announced and it will be on Coruña on September this year. And you can follow all the updates on Twitter. It's related with that, but I would prefer to mention that beforehand, that the Mesa driver, the Intel Mesa driver for Linux, is now conformance. I don't know if everybody is, knows what that means. That means that basically Kronos, that is managing OpenGL, just has a test suite. So you pass all the tests, you get certified as conformance. And Intel got this to be conformance since day zero, well, or day one, as you prefer to see that. And that includes passing the test for this extension that is part of the thing that I'm going to explain on this presentation. So what are the topics that I'm going to cover? I will make as an introduction to what is everything, what I'm talking about, what is this work related with. I will also make a summary of the development history, what we found when we started, what issues we had, and how we solved those issues that led to the technical decisions, to the work that we did. I also mention how we test the work that we do, and finally, a summary of the current status and future. An introduction. Okay. First, who is doing all this work? The initial work was done by Nikolai Hanel. I'm not sorry if I pronounced that wrongly. And right now, it's myself, it's Eduardo Lima, and Neil Roberts from Igalia. And this work is supported by Intel. So,
can I interrupt for 1 second? We only have audio on one side. I have mono.
Okay.
Hopefully it's this. Better now?
Hello, hello. 1, 2, 3. Testing, testing. Okay, sorry. So, okay, introduction. Okay, I'm going to make some brief introduction to the main term that I'm going to use. And the first one is probably everybody of you are already used to GLSL. It's the OpenGL sharing language. It has been used as the OpenGL language since 2004. It's a kind of C-like language, and one of the things, I mean, one of the features is that the setting, the source code is included with your program. So it's not exactly private. I mean, even if you try to do that, in the end, the driver should be capable to get that code. Some people didn't like that. I mean, here we are, everybody is open source minded, so probably for all of us it's not a problem, but for all other people from the industry it was a problem. And then we have SPIRB. It was initially introduced as just SPIR for OpenGL. In this case is a binary format, so they solve these private problems. And initially it was based on LLVM. And then SPIRB was announced on 2015 and became part of OpenCL 2.1 and Vulkan. That is probably the reason that they added this B. And in that case, it stopped to be based on LLVM. And it now is just one spec. So what we have now is that at that moment, is that we have OpenGL and Vulkan, and each one has different sharding language. One was using GSLL, and the other one was using SPIRB. But at the same time, people wanted to use both. The people were porting from one to the other. So it was needed some kind of interoperability between them. So the first one was this extension that but this was for Vulkan. That is, this extension defines how a Vulkan program could use GLSL. But in this case, it's not a kind of extension for Vulkan itself. It's a kind of front-end extension. It means that, for example, if you have a compiler that we're already doing GLSL to SPSV conversions, this one defines the scope for this compiler, what we expect from this transition. So after this one, they provided the equivalent, but for OpenGL. That is the main topic of this presentation, that is RSV GL SPSV. This one defines, in this case, defines two things. One is the ability for OpenGL to load SPSV modules, and the other is also this front-end definitions about which features from GLSL we want from in this case. So in this case, it's at the same time a driver and front-end extension. And there is also another small extension called SPSV extensions. It is because the previous extension, it's based on SPSV 1.0. So what happens if we want to extend that functionality? So these extensions allow to expose which extra features we have. And the spec implies that in some cases we will get some OpenGL specific SPSV extensions. And related with these extensions and related with this front end, the Kronos, in addition to the extensions, also creates a reference front ends. One is GLSLang, that, for example, it's used the definition of these extensions to create SPSV binaries based on GLSL. And they also maintain SPSV tools that are tools to manage SPSV modules like assembler, disassembler, a validator, etc. So we have, if you are experienced with OpenGL, you already know that GSL has has been used for a long time. So one of the reasons they define the extensions is to reduce the scope. So, for example, the first extension that I mentioned remove a lot of features, all GSL features, and add some kind of Vulkan-like features. And then we have the OpenGL extension that use that one as base, but at the same time it changes a lot some things. Like, yes, I know, it's confusing. It was confusing the first time that I read that, because the second extension removes some GLSL extensions, remove some Vulkan extensions, and add the specific ones and tweak existing ones. So, for example, subroutines were removed on both. But, for example, atomic counters were removed on the first one and then re-added on the second one. So, and the spec says that. They have a list of these features were removed on the previous extension, but we are now including again. But the big change here, in my opinion, was that in SPSV, the names of the variables, uniforms, UBOS, etc., are considered like debug information, so are optional. And they are maintaining that here. So, for example, a front end could get a GLSL shader and then create the binary without any names. So that means that in OpenGL, when you load the SPSV, it needs to work without any names, because it's optional. In fact, I will mention that later, but in fact, our approach is, as it is optional, we are not implementing that for now. We will implement that in the future, but for now, we are not taking into account the names that come from the SPSV binary, because it needs to work without them. So it's another way to test that our code is correct. And if you don't have names, then you need to use locations, bindings, indexes, etc. So I'm going to make a kind of development history about how this goes. So the prehistory, how the interest for implementing this extension started, It started on 2016. All these things that I have on quotes are emails that people send to MesaDev. So I don't know. I don't know that the name of that person. It used a kind of nickname. So it sent an email saying asking about the interest to implement that extension. So several driver developers from started to say, well, I could prefer this way and the other way, etc. And some months, almost a year later, Nikolai sent a request for comments thread to MesaDev. It's included a starting point with some code. It also has some questions. It was also focused on Radiant C, and some people started to jump about the approach, but it didn't went too far from there. It also mentions slightly the testing, but yeah, the thread was not really long. So Galia, the company I'm working for, jumped on the implementation of this extension on around September last year, mainly because Nicola at that point didn't have plans to continue to work on this. So, but we used his code as a reference and was really, really useful as a starting point. And he had a code for Mesa and Piglet. I will explain what is Piglet later, but yes, it's a test suite, a different test suite for OpenGL. So our first steps were integrating it with the Mesa driver, with the Intel Mesa driver. Sorry, there's a missing word there. And start to use the CTS test for this extension in order to evaluate what was missing. And one of the things that was based in that code, it was in near, the thing, I don't know if everybody is used to this terminology, but on compilers, when you have a language, you usually create a kind of tree intermediate representation. Sorry, I'm not a compiler. I am not a person with a background on compilers, so sorry if I explained that poorly. But basically, you parse the language and you get an intermediate representation. And that intermediate representation, there are several approaches. So on OpenGL, they have one, and at some point, Intel decided to create a different one. They started to use that, and then for different reasons, that is, there are plenty of talks around if you are interested. But Intel started to use that, and then other drivers started to use that too. So, not for as an utility, other based on NIR. So, for example, on Intel Mesa driver, we have a chain like you start with the GLSL shader, you create, it is passed to the GLSL IR representation, then this translated to NIR, and it finally converted to the more low-level Intel IR. And when Intel created wrote the Vulkan driver, they created a SPIRB to NIR pass by passing the one of the intermediate languages that were around. And why they didn't just remove that representation? The reason at that moment is that there is a linking based on NIR. So the linking is done on the previous intermediate representation, that is Mesa IR. So NIR is this intermediate representation, but the objects are already linked. And again, a definition of a compiler's topic from a non-compiler's, from a person without a compiler background. If you go to Wikipedia, this is a kind of generic definition. A linking is, when you compile, you usually compile different objects, and then you need to merge them together, and this is the link. More or less, you get the idea. On Mesa, if you abstract a lot, the GLSL linker does two things, two main things. Gather info from all the objects, because the GLSL shaders are really, you can query a lot of state information from them. And that information is also used for validate, because you can have one shader and another shader, but they are using the same UBO, but the definition should be the same, so it needs to be validated. So the first approach from Nikolai was trying to reuse the IR linker as much as possible. So he's taking into account that we have the NIRB, but what he did was creating, taking only the variables and converting them to GLSL IR variables, and trying to reuse as much IR linker as possible. And then after that, it used the new shader as usual. That was a really good approach for the Bootstrap. That allowed it to have a lot of the linking already done, so it allowed it to test the code with several cases and getting some shaders working. But the part is later. Sorry. So after all this introduction, then we started to code. We started to get into the dirt. So the first approach was trying to get the CTS test passing. The two main reasons. Well, I thought that was with that. The main reason to use the CTS test it was they covered most of the spec as normal, as it was intended, and at the same time there weren't too many tests, there were like 8, so it gave us a lot of it had a limited scope. We can gather them. The other thing, I mean, probably other people on our team didn't expect that, but at least I didn't expect that. That we needed to add more features that on SpeedB to NIR that intended. But if you think that is that is normal. The thing is that at that moment the SpeedB to NIR pass was focused on Vulkan, so it was focused on it has only the features that Vulkan needed. But there was some SpeedB features that were defined on the spec were left out, because it was only needed for OpenGL, and that includes atomic counters, transform feedback, tessellations, and we also need to do some tweaking on how the SpeedB to NIR pass handled UBOs and SSBOs. Oop. I don't know where I am. Okay, so at that moment when we started to code and to trying to get the CTS test passing and all that thing, we started to rethink about the linking. And the thing is that, as I said, this trick to convert, I put that in the opposite, the arrow is in the opposite direction, it's NIR variables to IR variables. But that trick, as I said, allowed us to get quickly some stuff supported. For example, we added support for atomic counters using that trick initially. But at the same time, it seemed somewhat artificial because all the information was on the near shader. And especially we started to find that there were a lot of changes coming from the spec that were not covered by the existing linker. And the poster boy were UBOs. On GLSL, it is based on the name. You have a name of a UBO, and it's assumed that if you have the same name on different shaders, it should be the same. Explicit binding is optional. And without explicit binding, the linker needs to set a binding for that UBO. But now, as the names are optional, so an option means that it needs to work without them, it's the opposite. Explicit binding is mandatory, so we need to base the linking on explicit bindings and forget the names. There are some layouts that are not supported. So for example, on UBOs, right now there are, we can only use one layout. There's a typo there, sorry. And that means that, for example, all UBOs are active, because on the linker, on the GLSL linker, there is a lot of code just to evaluate if a UBO is active or not. So that means that in the end, for UBOs and others, there isn't too much GLSL IR linker to use. So the thing is that at that moment we were finding that we will need to write a lot of new code for the linker, and we started to think it is really worth to add that support for the GLSL linker, especially if we don't have a GLSL IR representation. What we have at that moment is the near shader. And additionally, we have other developers, in this case, I mentioned Timothy Asher, but probably others, that were adding some helpers related with linking based on near. So we decided at the moment to switch and started to write a linker based on near. There I list all the reasons that I mentioned there. And for the people worried about, I mean, it is true that it's a lot of work, but the scope is really defined, because at this moment, GLSPRB doesn't include all features that the current linker needs to support. The thing is that, as I said, GLSL has been around from 2004. So that means that Mesa linker right now needs to support features coming from more than 10 years ago. So at that moment, we have a clear plan. The clear plan was greeting everything based on a near linker, and we focus on getting the CTS test passing. As I say, it's we're covering most of the spec, specifically a lot of the corner cases related with mappings and all the things, and there weren't too many. The tricky part here is that in the same way that our implementation were a work in progress, those tests were also a work in progress. So we used a lot of, well, I can say a lot of time testing, reviewing, submitting feedback, and even fixes for those tests. It reached version 21. So it was a long review and feedback. Especially because this review, I mean, we were not the only ones doing the review. We were the ones from Inter, for the Inter Mesa driver doing review, but there are some people from MED and there are some people from NVIDIA providing the feedback. So, as I said in the beginning and the introduction, we got those tests passing, and that allowed us to get around October, November, I don't remember exactly when. And that was enough to get the CTS conformance test passing, at least related with those tests. So at that moment, we started to clean the code. We started to submit patches to MesaDev. I will mention more about that later. And the code was clean enough for the submission. So some people will start to wonder if that was enough. I mean, if we are passing the conformance test, that means that everything is done. No. Although we were passing the CTS test, it was not production ready. The CTS test was focused more on the on following the spec in really on all the specifics of the specification, but we're not really they didn't test too much on the execution. And probably they will extend that later, but I don't know, probably they will keep the current focus and assume that if the specific for the station works, then everything else is covered by the other tests. I don't know what will be their plans. So at that moment, we have two options to how to approach things. One was mentioned, is improve Piglet, and the other was working on a GLSL to SPRB backend. So Piglet, Piglet is another test suite. This, in this case, was public, was open source since the beginning, and it's really used a lot for the Mesa project. And really, but okay, this is also a typo. Heavily used by Piglet developers, of course. Piglet is used a lot by Piglet developers. But what I wanted to say is used by Mesa developers. And one of the utilities that includes is ShadowRunner. ShadowRunner runs. It uses a text file where you put then the source code of the shader, the values for the uniform, for the UVOs, etc., and then it also you can put what is the expected outcome. So when you run this test with ShadowRunner, it's checked at the end. The main advantage of this is that it's really, really easy to write a new test. And Nikolai added support for GLSPV for the Piglet test. It mainly two things. It's a new script that parses this text file for the side runner, and then use GLSLang to create the SPV binaries. And it also adds some. It also tried to fix the shaders. The thing is that some of the shaders, as I said before, the spec also includes what kind of GLSL you expect when you do the conversion. So, for example, explicit locations for uniforms are mandatory, but a lot of the tests of Piglet doesn't include a location because are old and at that time there was not needed. So this script tries to fix the shader, assigning locations and a lot of things. So in order to extend what they want to test. And the other thing that Nikolai added to Piglet was support on ShadowRunner to load the SPV binary. So you have an option, SPV, and then you can run. I think I mentioned that on the previous slide. Okay, you can switch easily. That means that you can run one test by default using GLSL, and just passing one option, it loads the binary. And as I said, you can write tests easily. I mean, and for us, it was a really, really, really useful tool because, I mean, you could read one shader and run on the already working path, and then just using a new option on the command line, you run the SPV binary. Well, we loved it. We used it a lot. It was our alpha objective was passing the CTS test in order to improve I think that these features were what we use more to get the code evolving. And well, we also added some features. The thing is that, as I said before, the GLSPV says that things should work without names. And the thing is that the Piglet, in order to feed the data, was using the OpenGL approach that was, for example, for UBOs, that was using the name of the UBO and ask for the uniform, and then with that index started to say where is everything and put them there. But with the SPV, we don't have names, so we needed to change how to feed the data for UBOs and SSBOs. Well, no, sorry, for SSBOs was already in place, only for UBOs. And finally, about all this work on Piglet, both for Nikolai and both for us, it is not clear if it is going to go upstream. The thing is that some people, when it was debated in the past, some people were having some doubts about changing the ShadowRunner, and especially some people have doubts about adding a dependency on Piglet for GLSLang for different reasons. The other approach also mentioned that it was first mentioned on May was create a GLSL to SPV backend. The idea will be that Mesa itself will include a way to convert ELSL to SPIRB. The main advantage will be provide an alternative to ELSLAN, that right now is the main way to get ELSL shaders to SPIRB. And just in case some people think that is just a Kronos tool for amateurs, I think that, for example, for the last version of the Doom game, I think that they use ELSLAN to convert from ELSL to SPIRB. The other advantage were optimizations, in the sense that the ELSL compiler has several optimizations, so the idea will be, sorry?
What's the proposal, though, if you do this for Mesa developers? Are they supposed to run all the shader runners twice every time they want to check their patches?
Right now, this is not a proposal, because as I have just said, it's not as easy as just the switch, because also how you feed the data is different. So at least the linking will be, I mean, all the tests that involves linking, we could do this, as you say, running it twice. But yes, I mean, there is a lot of details about how this testing will work, because it's not just testing running it twice. In fact, one of the things that Nicolas was doing, that I didn't mention that, was also creating a kind of blacklist. I mean, this and this and this test can be run that. So if extending that approach, the idea will be running twice only the whitelisted test. But yes, the testing right now is mostly focused on getting the extension, the development of the extension going on, and at some point, we will need to define a better policy. In fact, this is what I said before. It is not clear if all these changes on Piglet will be go extreme, because with this approach, you don't need change on Piglet to get the SPIRB binaries. Because, as I said on the next slide, well, it's in the following one. In this slide, the idea will be that internally, I don't know, probably an environment variable, you will ask MESA, or MESA, how do you pronounce MESA? Because we are Spanish and we pronounce MESA, but probably MESA is okay. So that internally, I don't know, an environment variable, like use SPIRB, that in the normal chain will be ELSL, ELSL IR, and then NIR, but internally create a ELSL, ELSL IR, SPIRB, and then SPIRB to NIR. In that way, there are two things that that will be tested, SPIRB to NIR, and also the support of this extension. The thing is that internally you will also need to do this fixing that Piglet was doing. I mean, this shader doesn't have a explicit location, so internally we create a explicit location for this test. That will allow to run the Piglet test without change, but the way to fill the data will be still different. It's, I don't know, probably in the end it will be some kind of compromise, something like don't use ELSLAN to create the SPIRB, but use that approach and then make a small change on other runners to fit the data to the test. In any case, in relation why, if people ask if we are using that, it's not finished. And for example, one of the things that is missed, because it's not finished in the sense that in the previous slide, Ian Romanik sent the first version on October, and some people started to review that, but it's not finished. And this first series is not still fully reviewed, and it's not still merged, and it's also a work in progress. For example, one thing that it was missing was UBOs, so in my case, I was working on that. I need to rely on Piglet. Okay, so I don't know how much time I have. Okay. Okay. Sorry if I was speaking too fast, but it's what happens when you in this presentation. So okay, what's working right now? As I said, we got all the CTS tests passing, and then we have a little of everything partially covered. We have uniform, we have atomic counters, we have UBOs, we have tessellation, we have transform feedback. So we have, well, when I say plenty of programs, I mean obviously tests, because the current support is not enough for a real application. And this small extension that is about SPO extensions is fully complete, but that was really, really small. So what's missing? For all these filters, it's missing to polish them, to test them. It's also missing arrays of arrays. That is the way that OpenGL calls multidimensional arrays. We have some support, but we have still something to fix on the SPIRB to near pass. We miss multi-sample image array that we need to add more validation. The thing is that this, the spec says or SPET that SPIRB binary is correct, but SPET that is correct each module. But at the end, we will need to make some kind of validations when you are using different modules, each module for each stage. And obviously, it is more testing. And more testing means not only add more testing, but as we were just mentioning before, agree on something. I mean, agree on what we do, on the policy, or whitelisting, etc. And it will be complicated. I mean, it will be not trivial. For the plans of the streaming, right now we have around 80 patches, more or less, and the plan is sending small batches now and then. We send an initial one on November. I don't know, it was like 20 or something patches. It's partly reviewed, some of them were already pushed, but it's still pending through the final review. We send the fourth version in January. And I think that's all. I hope not forgot something. So, if you have any question?
Have you thought about OpenCL integration?
No, not at all. Sorry, we were really focused on only the OpenGL. But yes, I know that there were some threats from MesaDev related with OpenCL. But I think that they are still using LLVM or something. I mean,
yeah, because of SPIRB not necessarily always being just SPIRB in their versions.
Yeah.
And the LLVM branch with SPIRB support appears to be the one to use if you want to do OpenCL stuff.
Yeah. But yes, I know there are. It's curious that there are several. People in parallel working on a kind of SPIRB support for but yes, we are only focused for the OpenGL. And in fact, as far as you know, the OpenCL is really out of the OpenGL support. So I think that in the end, probably they will be really different. In both OpenGL and OpenCL, I think that the support will be somewhat different. It will be awesome to share some of this, but and at the same time, as I said before, this extension defines a really defined scope for OpenGL. So I'm not sure if the OpenGL and OpenCL needs will be the same. Even although they are SPIRB, I'm not sure that the needs will be the same. Yes. So you were contributing, so you are? Ah, okay. Thank you to you for the initial work.
I don't really have a question, but about the whole testing thing, I mean, the reason why we want to run maybe not everything, but everything except the blacklist twice, or at least what I would like to do it, is that just because a feature works in the GLSL path, I mean, even if you share the backend, there could still be issues in how you translate the SPIRB and everything that makes a feature break. So you really would like to test all the features in both paths.
Yeah.
And I know that this is something that the OpenGL working group is also interested in. I mean, you said there are these 8 tests in the CTS, right? And they're kind of ridiculous.
Yeah. Yeah, but it would be somewhat rude to say that on a presentation.
I mean, it came up in the discussions there also that maybe it would be nice to be able to run functionality tests also in the CVE setting. And I mean, the CTS is kind of a weird code base, and
yeah.
It doesn't have something like a shader runner.
This is the reason we used so much the Shadow Runner. I mean, writing a test with Shadow Runner is really easy, like 1 minute to 30 seconds if it is really small. But with CTS, it's like the other advantage is that with Shadow Runner, you just modify a text file and you run it. With CTS, you have to write the C++ code, compile, and it's annoying.
So the point is mostly just saying that there might be interest from non Mesa people as well. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, to add some support to CTS to this.
Whether it will be imported to the CTS, who knows, but I know they're also using Piglet, so.
So NVIDIA is also using Piglet. Ah, okay, it's good to know. Okay.
Yeah, the problem I have with just reusing large sections of Piglet, running in a different mode, even with a blacklist, is that eventually it's not scalable. I think Piglet, over time, has incrementally added small tests to touch specific parts of the GL when we're implementing features. But this is not the first example where there's a bigger feature and the idea is like, well, let's just run it twice in a different mode. So like the shader cache is another thing that has no specific Piglet tests, and the testing strategy is to run it once and then run it again with the shader cache enabled. And you know, like if you
well,
with Piglet, you can't shard out the tests in any way to scale it to lots of machines, and it's unreasonable for developers to wait for two and a half hours to touch every.
Yeah, in any case, just one thing. I mean, as we were talking about this running twice, we internally are adding tests, and we are using internally, but we internally are not doing this executing two times other tests. We are adding tests internally for us, and
So
what I mean is that probably it will be the two things. I mean, probably when we get this our test mature enough, and if they approve some GLSLang or SPIRB tools on Piglet, that I don't know if they are going to do that, we will add some, I don't know, let's say about 100 tests specifically for SPIRB. So the idea of running twice the others will be extend the coverage. So the mean is that, or at least is what I would like to do, is having some tests only for this feature to test. I mean, it's impossible to test everything, but to test most of it. For example, I have like 10 UBOs tests, but that probably could be go there. I mean, it's a UB test, it's a basic one with an array, one with two UBOs. And I think that makes sense to include them and not just focus on the other extensions, because as you say, that will be problematic. I mean, because those tests, for example, I remember that when I was working on the SSBO, I started using the already existing SSBO test, but those tests were not using special location, so I needed to use that. So I think, well, okay, for the first step we'll do that, but then I will write my own test just for me. So I think that in the end probably will be a compromise. Well, at least I would like to be something like that. Okay, so any other question? Okay, so I think that's all. Thank you.